Yo, yo, what's up? This is Diamond D representing Digging in the Crates right here, and you're tuned in to Day One Radio. Keep it right there for that real hip-hop, you heard?
Welcome back to another episode, another installment of Day One Radio right here on ablradio.com. That's Art Beats and Lyrics Radio to be exact. Make sure you download the very free, very accessible smartphone app for your iPhone and Android devices. And B, tell them where they can check out the entire Day One catalog at, man.
DayOneRadio.com, iTunes, as well as SoundCloud and Spreaker and anywhere else they got podcasts. So we appreciate y'all listening. Make sure you rate us and like us on iTunes so we can keep bringing y'all quality material. And once again, it's always dope to have who I consider to be legends in the game in the show. I think this is one of the first people we talked about that we wanted to get on when we first started the podcast, what, 2.5 years ago.
Right.
One of the dopest producers, dopest MCs on the mic. Whether you've been paying attention or not, this man got 28 years in the game, heavy. Gotta respect that. The one and only Diamond D. How you doing, brother?
What up? What's good? What's good? How you doing, man?
I see Diamond at shows all the time. I'll never see him smile. He actually damn near cracked a smile at that intro. Almost. Almost. And
yeah, what's up,
man? Please introduce your new artist, man.
This is my artist, Mikey J. What's up, Mike? Talk to them, man. Say what's up.
Hey, what's going on, y'all, man? This is a blessing right here. Real talk, man.
Cool. And for the record, this is podcast, this is radio, so you ain't got to worry about us putting the wrong picture.
Right.
And he saw that.
And guess what? Shorty from BET called me today. She was very apologetic. She said that she's going to fix it immediately.
Tight. Good. You know, for those that didn't catch that inside joke, man, they did an inside label. I don't know if y'all been watching it. It's been a pretty dope series so far, but inside the label, man. On BET. They were talking to Fat Joe and asked him, who discovered you, Fat Joe? And they did not throw Diamond D face up on them when he said Diamond D found me. So we had to make sure we got this straight.
He said my name and they flashed somebody else's face. You know, it's just crazy. And you would think that somebody up at BET should be hip-hop literate.
But you know, you'll be surprised about these documentaries sometimes, man, because like I was in the VH1 ATL documentary, right? So I got a chance to be like in the editing bay with the producers for a minute, and I was watching like the original edit,
right?
And I was like, that ain't the Youngblood, Shawty. That's the Yin-Yang twins, dog.
See, you know what I'm saying? They got to get it together.
They do, man. But shoot, man, I mean, a lot of folks don't know this, man. Like, you've been in the A for quite a bit, man.
I'm in and out. But, you know, I've been coming to Atlanta back when, put it this way, the first time I performed in Atlanta, it was a club called The Phoenix.
Which is
on Marietta.
You know what I mean? That was back in the day. That was early 90s.
Right.
So like Lil John used to DJ there, I believe, man.
See that? So this is before it became The Warehouse.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So that's how long I've been coming down here. When I first started coming down here, I was doing a lot of production with Dallas Austin. He had groups called Illegal. Shades of Lingo.
Yep.
Joy. Me, Eric Sermon. We were basically down here, you know, giving him that funk.
That's what's up. So, and you also, I mean, a lot of people don't know that you really helped break Outkast to an extent in New York by doing that remix, the Southern Playalistic remix.
Exactly. Yeah, I did the remix for Southern Playalistic. And, you know, at the time, they wasn't getting a lot of love in New York. So the remix I did, you know, kind of helped them get ushered into New York, so to say. And, you know, that's one of my biggest moments musically.
You know what I'm saying? It's like, I mean, ain't gonna lie, like being from here, you know, a lot of times being a hip-hop fan, like it's almost like you was raised to be, like, to have some angst towards New York cats because they always thought that New Yorkers always looked down upon us. But, I mean, from what I can tell, it was like you've always kind of had, like, a more of, like, a
open arm, open-minded policy to, like, you know, exactly. where you're working and how you're working. But, like, where do you think you, like, inherited that from? Did it take convincing from some dope groups
Not at all, you know. With me specifically, you know, Dallas requested me to come down here. So me and Eric Sermon, we were down here, like, in 93.
Yeah.
It wasn't even called the A yet. And, you know, we were down here working with Atlanta artists. You know what I mean? So, you know, I've always had the love for artists down here.
And you mentioned something I hadn't thought about, Shades of Lingo, in probably over a decade. You
see what I'm saying?
You took it back with that, for sure.
That's right. That's right.
So, let's start at the beginning, man. Forest Projects in the Bronx. You started off as a DJ. Where did that love come from? I mean, obviously the DJ was king,
right?
You know, at that moment. So, like, who kind of made you in your projects or in your area made you think, like, oh, I want to start spinning. I can actually do this.
I guess the easy response would be to name the DJs people are more familiar with from the Bronx, which would be Grand Wizard Theodore, Grandmaster Flash, DJ Charlie Chase from the Cold Crush Four, and they all influenced me, but. A direct influence would be these two gentlemen from my projects named DJ Supreme and DJ Hutch. They would come outside, you know, at least once or twice a week in the summertime and set up their equipment. And, you know, as time grew on, they eventually took me into the fold and put me under their wings. So I would say those two, even though they're not really heard of or known outside of the tri-state, those two gentlemen are directly responsible for me wanting to be a DJ as a kid.
I'm sure it was a gang of kids, though, in the projects that wanted to be DJs. What made them embrace you?
Well, basically, you know, I had a little mismatch set upstairs, and I would practice. And one day, Supreme let me get on the equipment, and he saw what I was able to do, and he was impressed. I also had, at that point, a fairly knowledgeable knowledge of breakbeats for a young kid. So that impressed them too, because I had some records that they didn't even know about. You know what I mean? So I guess it's just a combination of those two. You know what I mean?
Yeah, because the thing about that DJing, it's almost like how those old jazz players used to come up. Like, they didn't let you in the door if you did not know how to at least hit certain notes. Or right. Know who came before you. So it's like, you know, for cats to take you under their arm DJing, they really had to respect you, for real,
right,
man.
Right, right, exactly.
For sure. So how did you go from that DJing to getting into production, getting into actually making records with the Ultimate Force?
Okay, well, let me just say first off that most producers were DJs at one time.
Yeah, no doubt.
You know,
I wish it was still that way.
Yeah, but a fairly high percentage of producers were DJs at one time. It's just a natural progression. DJ Jazzy J from the Zulu Nation. When I met him in the Bronx, he was big. You know, he had basically crafted the sound of Def Jam.
Yeah.
You know, he produced the first three or four singles on Def Jam. I Need a Beat.
It's Yours.
It's Yours, right. Cold Rock stuff. Anyway, that whole wave. And he basically took me and Master Rob under his wing, and he signed us. And just being around the studio watching him. And again, he took a liking to us. He was into Rob. And then when he met me, again, he was impressed with my knowledge of records that I had, you know, as a teenager. So, you know, we would go to the studio, you know, we work on our craft, and just watching him. Back then, it was the SP-12, wasn't even the 1200, it was the SP-12. Just watching him program and make beats, you know, it just just became something that I wanted to pursue. You know what I mean? It's just a natural progression.
Yeah, and I think I first heard of, before I even knew of you as a solo artist, the Wake Up Show would play Ultimate Force records, and obviously they started a couple years after you guys had already been through your whole trying to put out an album. The album didn't come out and all of that, but they would go back and play records, and then it dawned on me, I'm like, okay, this is the same cat, you know, Best Kept Secret, same cat produced the Lord Finesse records and all of that, so...
Right.
it was like looking back on your career, it kind of feels like you were ready, you were prepared, but you were always in the right place at the right time. Is that the case?
Yeah, you know, it's crazy. I guess you could say that. You know, to me, I can't really look back and say that, but I guess in some aspects, that is correct. You know, Lord Finesse, you know, he was from our projects. And after the Ultimate Force came out, you know, we were like the big dogs on the block. Even though the song didn't really blow nationally, we had a strong tri-state buzz, which is New York, Connecticut, and New Jersey. We had a crazy tri-state buzz. And again, Finesse lived across the street. And I think it was like 1990 when Finesse, he got his deal at Wild Pitch Records. And he asked me and DJ Premier and Showbiz to produce his first album, Funky Technician. And that's basically where everything just kind of snowballed from.
And that's crazy because, I mean, at that point, that's, you know, the cats that were at Wild Pitch for the most part. But
right.
When you look back, like, my debut album is produced by Showbiz, Diamond D, and DJ Premier. Dude, that's insane.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like,
right. And this is before Main Source and OC.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, this is actually the wave right after Chill Rob G and Lakim Shabazz and that whole thing over there at Wild Pitch. So, yeah, it's just crazy how it worked out.
And that album is still
Bangs.
To this day. Like, and, you know, a lot of people, if you're at Hip Hop Head, you obviously know the sample from Black Caesar
right.
that ended up being much later on gaining huge popularity with Dos Effects and They Want Effects, man. So what was your thoughts, man, when you first heard them flip? I guess it was Eric Sermon flipped it.
I said, yo, it's some biting ass niggas.
Finesse in effect, cause I rhyme hard. Look good, flow smooth, yeah, the whole nine yards. Win, tear, MCs that submit. I make the girl strip naked and just give it here. It's like taking candy from a kid in a baby carriage. Suckers vanish because I do crazy damage. Crews I smoke in this, don't even joke with this. Just listen to the sounds of the phone from vocalist.
Ain't that something? Damn, it feels good to see people up on it. Ain't that something? Damn, it feels good to see people.
A man with intellect, knowing the disrespect. I kick the rhyme and make them C's wanna hit the deck and give it up and use their rhymes as a sacrifice. Brothers try their best, they ain't even half as nice. They try to kick it by using that sofa rap. Me sound whack, nigga, please come off of that. I'm mystical, musical, I might confuse a few. Lord Finesse getting funky as usual, releasing some fresh work, sparking a network, cause I'm the expert. Wearing sneakers and sweatshirts, jeans and hoods, there's no doubt that I rap good. I walk with a bop with my hat turned back. Was too many. I may look like a hoodlum, but I'm a rapper and a pretty damn good one. Cause I could get smooth and mellow while like a juvenile. Or get swift with the gift and just lose the crowd. State the facts, create the raps. Those who try to down me, better step out my face with that. Cause I could get raw like many or any one of them. I'll take a 9 when you rate me from 1 to 10. I got skills, so don't try approaching me. I keep rhymes in stores just like groceries. Don't try to snap, true, cause it's man be strapped. Come correct, you be leaving home.
Word up. But guess what? I love that song. You know what I mean?
It's a dope song.
I'm not going front. When I heard it, I said, yo, the fuck is these niggas just took my little shit? But you know what? Guess what? James Brown owns that music.
Yeah.
But you know, I was the first one definitely to touch it and put it out there for the world to enjoy.
Man, definitely. Too bad Twitter wasn't out back then, goddamn. You could have had a whole campaign behind this.
Yeah, yeah. But you know, you got to watch that because, like I said, you know, it's one thing to be the first to touch it, but, you know, I don't own that music.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So it is what it is, but I was definitely the first one to put hands on the Black Caesar joint.
And that's not the only time.
No.
Because didn't Chubb Rock also have a joint?
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. He bit too. And your man, what's his name? Because he bit too. Son of Berserk.
Oh, change the style. Yeah, that dude.
Right. You know,
and it was crazy because all you guys had to know each other. Eric Sadler, you know what I mean? Him and his brother, Eric Sermon.
Well, you know what? Strong City was distributed by Uni.
Okay.
And Son of Berserk album just happened to be on Uni. You know, as far as Chubb Rock and Howie T, I guess maybe they felt that the Ultimate Force record did whatever it was going to do at that point.
Right.
And in all honesty, when they did it, it kind of went to the next level. Because I remember seeing Chubb Rock on Soul Train performing that song. And I was like, damn, me and Rob, and we didn't even make it to Soul Train. And here go Chubb Rock. But at that point, Chubb Rock was much bigger than the Ultimate Force.
And things, that's what money brings. If you act like you know, I'll put you under my wing. If you act otherwise and try to demise me, take me for granted to try to surprise me. I'm not a drag, I'll break your legs because you're yellow, just like the yolk of an egg. He's DJ Diamond D, and I'm the master of MCs biting my rhymes like they were corn on the car. Or should I say cake from the bites you take? Know what I'm saying? I'm not playing. You know, bro, that I'm an MC pro, and like a Lamborghini, I'm geared to go. I was raised in Forest, across from Morris. I got more hair on my chest than Chuck Norris. Smooth as suede, sharp as a blade. I'm not a name, but rap is the trade. Getting paid and laid, having made in the shade. Hear me riding in my car, you think it was a parade. Sweet as lemonade, it's not a game of charades. Know what I'm saying? I'm not playing. Sweat me, they should just let me go my way, but they just can't forget me. Is it my rhyme or my personality? Could it be my values or morality? Whatever the case, people stay in my face. It's starting to irk me. They try
definitely
to me,
so were you ever, I mean, obviously you didn't start off trying to be a solo artist at all. I mean, I've heard you say before the Best Kept Secret single was even recorded as part, you know, just you had time during an Ultimate Four session.
Right.
So let me just go ahead and bang that out. And it was supposed to be a bonus track. Were you ever an apprehensive solo artist, or were you just like, forget it, and I'm just going to go for it?
Looking back, I was a little apprehensive. At the same time, I was like, you know, fuck it. I'm, you know, because I, at that point, you know, you, I had been around MCs for a while. And
yeah.
You know, I kind of figured out, how to put words together and things of that nature, being around Lord Finesse and Grand Poobah Maxwell at that time. You know, they were also on Strong City Records. And this is the start of the brand Nubian. So I'm around all these dope MCs, and I just recorded the song. And a lot of people liked it. And when the Ultimate Force album wound up getting shelved, I was like, yo, I want this shit. This shit needs to be heard. You know what I mean? So we were talking to Capitol Records at one time, and they were interested. But at the end of the day, Mercury Polygram, they're the ones who stepped up and offered me a budget, and that's ultimately where Stunts, Blunts, and Hip Hop wound up at.
So, like, as a producer, though, when you choose to, you know, add that into your repertoire, being an MC,
right?
How much of you are like, all right, man, I'm keeping all the beats to myself, and how much of you is like, well, I'm still getting checks being a producer. Let me share some of the wealth too. Like what? Right. Like, what's the balance in that, man?
Well, I definitely kept a lot of bangers that I was just holding on to, but at the same time, if you want to be a prolific producer, you can't keep everything for yourself. You know what I mean? You definitely have to find a balance. So, you know, I'm just lucky everything worked out the way it did.
Yeah, can I remember, like, you know, we've had, like, David Banner in here a couple times,
right,
which is, like, he's a producer and MC as well. Right. And, like, I remember him sharing certain instances of where, you know, he would sometimes keep the beats because he was like, I got to show y'all how to rap on my shit. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. It's crazy, though. Like, it's weird. Growing up in the Bay Area, being, I think I was in high school when Stunts, Blitz, and Hip Hop came out. And I don't know what the reaction was here in Atlanta, but in the Bay, like, you know, we obviously have super hip-hop heads.
Right.
But at the same time, most of my friends was listening to straight-up West Coast music.
Right.
So when I would pull it out, I'd be like, no, y'all need to listen to this, bro. Like, this album is crazy, and I could never quite put my finger on it of why I liked it so much. It was just, like, dope from beginning to end, and it opened me up to another chamber of East Coast music, and it's still dope to this day. Like, did you know during that time that you were making, like, timeless music?
I didn't. I was just, you know, just recording songs that I liked.
Okay.
And I just, you know, I was hoping that the world would like it too.
Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, they did, and right, it was a nice balance. Was it any joints that, like, the label really wanted you to do or really wanted you to push, whereas you was trying to push other stuff? Because it seemed like
they wanted a radio record, you know.
Yeah,
they wanted to make some of that budget money back. You know, so I recorded that song Confused,
which, yeah, which, you know, I remember that. Yeah,
and all my real hardcore hip hop fans were like, no. D, but you know, it's just one joint out of 21. So I did that, you know, just to appease the label, and they were fine with it, and then the album came out.
And people still go ahead. I didn't mean to cut you off.
No, cause I was going to say, like, I always hear that story about, like, oh man, the label made me do this. But like is it never a time?
No,
where, like,
wait. Nobody made me do nothing.
Okay,
But they said, D, you know, the album is great, but we need something for the radio.
Okay. You know, I always wondered, like, if it's actually
so
fun
it,
to
it,
do
it.
It
was a compromise because that was the last song I'd done.
Okay.
And they ain't even, y'all didn't even do a video for that record, did you?
Nah.
Yeah, I didn't think so. No. Not at all. Okay. Yeah, and it's funny because the album, it lives on, because every so many years, somebody else will go and flip something you did on that. I remember being at some party on the east side, and the beginning of a joint came on, and I was like, oh shit, they finna play I'm Out of Here? Right. Nigga. And it was Busta with New York Shit. I was like, oh, okay.
Right.
I was like, it keeps living on. It seems like every 4 or 5 years, somebody will take something else and flip it from that album.
No doubt.
Yeah, but it's definitely a classic record, man. And it how long did it take you to do that project? Because it seems like a pretty intensive joint.
Well, I wasn't really under any pressure to rush the project, but looking back at it, it might have took maybe 6 months to make.
Damn, that's it.
About 6 months.
That's, you know, that's no limit. Remember, right?
I already had the beats that I wanted to make.
Right? Okay. Yeah.
You know, so I already had, you know, the records I wanted to use. So it was just real organic, just the way how it came together. You know what I mean?
Right. No, earlier you mentioned Jazzy J and,
right,
and his kind of making the beats for the beginning of Def Jam and the foundation of Def Jam. But another thing is his studio and just kind of like his tutelage is a branch, is a tree
right,
that let off a whole lot of branches from you, Brand Nubian, like everybody recorded there. Do you, I feel personally, but I'm from a whole other side of the country, being from the Bronx, do you feel like Jay doesn't really get his just due as far as being a pioneer in this?
Yeah, definitely. I would say that. You know, I would definitely say that outside of the Zulu Nation and nationwide, I don't think Jazzy J is revered the way I revere him and a lot of other people in hip hop do. But that man right there, you know, aside from putting me on, you know, Grand Poobah Maxwell, excuse me, you know, he was part of the Soul Sonic So Sonic Force with that huge, huge hit Planet Rock. You know what I mean? So he did that. Like I said, the Def Jam stuff. The soundtrack to the movie Beat Street. Then you know, about 3 years later, he produced that hit for Busy Bee Suicide. And, you know, he just did a lot. You know what I mean? And, you know, after my project was done, I brought Lord Finesse around. I brought Showbiz and AG around. I brought Fat Joe around. And we all recorded our first albums at that studio. So, you know, Jazzy J definitely touched all of us. You know what I mean? So, like you say, it is a tree.
Definitely.
No Jazzy J, no Diamond D, no Diamond D, no Fat Joe, no Fat Joe, no Big Pun.
Yeah.
I mean, I can go on and on.
Definitely. You know? Definitely. Speaking of Fat Joe, I have to admit, when Flojo first came out, I was like, this beat is crazy, but this dude's flow is not the business. And he has grown exponentially over time. Like, did you see, like, star and legit longevity as an MC in him when you discovered him?
I did. You know, I definitely was into Joe. And you know what? Joe definitely has come a long way lyrically.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, we all have. You know, I don't spit the way I was spitting on Stunts, Blunts, and Hip Hop. And, you know, definitely Joe has come up. But, you know, the same criticism that you just gave Joe, he's aware of that, and a lot of people have said that. But, you know, looking back at it, you definitely can hear the progression. You know what I mean? So, you know, I agree with you.
Yeah.
No doubt.
So, you know, you discover Fat Joe. You guys put out the album on Relativity.
Right.
It did what it did.
Mm-hmm.
And then we started, you know, you did the Soul Clap record, classic record, Showbiz and AG.
Right.
And it was like, from the outside looking in, we saw all these different pieces.
Right.
And you were kind of the common denominator between all those pieces. Were you always thinking, digging in the crates crew, while you were doing this, or did it just kind of organically come together?
It organically came together. And, like, and you know, we were all from the same projects.
Yeah.
And like I said, since the Ultimate Force came out first, people looked up to me and Rob.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And maybe looked up to me a little more only because I was responsible for the music. You know, Rob was just an MC. But, you know, I was able, I had the knowledge and the records, you know, and so I was the one making the music. So a lot of artists just looked to me like, you know, okay, Diamond's the one that, you know, we should definitely fuck with.
Gotcha. So, but I mean, do you say it and it's like, it's another crew. Like, DITC is a legendary crew. Like, what were you guys thinking when you came together? Like, did you, because this is kind of before we had really had, I mean, you have Native Tongues, but other than that, we didn't really have like crews
right.
in music, especially cats with different record deals on different labels. From, you know, different right. areas within New York. Y'all held it down for the Bronx.
Different
but you also
too.
Had different talents, different... We didn't have different genres of hip-hop, but you know, you had... Joe was on the gangster shit. L was on the Harlem gangster shit. Like, y'all had a bunch of different chambers within
right.
one situation. Like,
right.
When did it kind of dawn on you, like, this is different? This is like, kind of like some groundbreaking stuff.
It didn't really appear different. It just... appear like just normal.
Hmm.
You know what I mean? Because we all grew up with each other for the most part, except Big L.
Right.
Big L came into the fold when Lord Finesse met him in Harlem. But me, myself, Fat Joe, Showbiz, Lord Finesse, us four directly came from the same projects. Well, Showbiz lived across the street, and AG's from Patterson Project, which is about maybe 10, 15 minutes away. So, like I said, we didn't know what to expect, but we all had a genuine love and passion for the music. You know what I mean? And then I think by the time the Showbiz and AG EP, with Can I Get a Soul Clap, when that EP came around, that's when we all collectively decided calling ourselves Digging in the Crates. At that point.
So are we still gonna get that DITC album?
Oh, DITC album, it just came out.
It did?
It just came out.
How the hell I missed that?
Yep, it just came out. It's available on www.ditcetc.com. DITC Entertainment, ETC.com. The album is out. Everybody's involved with it. And, you know, we got a bang. We got a couple of bangers on there. The joint with me, Fat Joe, and Lord Finesse. The joint with OC and Pharoah Monge. The new wave with Fat Joe, OC, and AG. You know, it's a lot of good music on there.
You know we living in a different time. So can people buy it on iTunes as well and all of that?
On iTunes, I believe it will be available soon. But you know, for vinyl.
Okay.
For vinyl, you could pick up the vinyl and the CD on that website, www.ditcetc.com.
Definitely. And me and Reese were talking about this earlier. As a DJ with a pretty, excuse me, extensive record collection, man, what do you think about this resurgence in vinyl?
I think it's great. You know, I've never stopped using vinyl, but, you know, I think it's great. I think Serato had a lot to do with that.
Yeah.
You know, people want to touch and feel a record. You know what I mean? So it's a good thing that vinyl is coming back around.
Yeah, cause I'm seeing stuff in damn Urban Outfitters and shit. I'm like, God damn, they got this next to this skinny ass goddamn t-shirt?
Yeah. You know, so that's a good thing.
You know what I'm saying? Being that, you know, like, you know, a lot of your production has been heralded, you know, for sampling, you know what I'm saying, and flipping samples.
Right.
Like, what is your current stance on sampling now? Because it seems like a lot of artists are, like, moving away from it, whether it be for
artists
like,
have moved away from
okay,
it.
Okay.
They have moved away from it. But to me, you know, I still sample, but I also do production that's sample-less.
Okay.
You know what I mean? It all depends on who I'm working with and how I'm feeling when I'm creating my music. You know what I mean? But I'm always going to be sample-based. It's just the essence to me.
Yeah, cause I always felt like, you know, when you remove that, like, you're pretty much, like, removing the stories that can be told, the legacies that are involved. You know what I'm saying? Not that anything's wrong with a original production, but it's like so many conversations get started from, like we were just talking about earlier, oh, man, I thought that was the song. So, no, this person did it first. Oh, you know what I'm saying? I mean, my pops put me on the hip-hop from that alone. What I'm saying? Would hear stuff like, man, that's George Clinton, so-and-so. Let me show you my record. You know, he would hear a Richard Pryor skit. That's Richard Pryor talking on there. And I'm like, damn, all right. Did not know it went that deep.
Yeah, so, you know, like I said, I'm always going to be sample-based. But, you know, I do work with artists and record labels who say, Diamond, we want to work with you, but, you know, we don't want to clear no samples. Hmm. So, you know, if you're a prolific producer, you know, you'll take that energy and then you'll just do what you have to do and try to create something that's, you know, that's sample-less but still can give you the feeling and the aura of being of something that was sampled.
Is the question with people not making as much money off the music business as they used to, have the prices that some of these legacy artists are charging for samples gone down?
Yes and no. You know what I mean? Because some artists feel that, you know, if you really want to use the music, you know, you'll pay for it. But, you know, I guess, you know, a lot of older artists who we sample from, some require advances and some don't.
Okay.
You know, some artists might say, well, you know what? We don't want no advance, but we want 30% of your publishing. You know, so it's different ways how you can organize it. You know, me myself, I would rather work like that. Keep the advance money and, you know, just give the artist, rightfully so, some publishing.
Right.
You know what I mean? Especially if you're using their music. You know what I'm saying? It's only right.
What did you think when your partner, Lord Finesse, tried to hit Mac Miller for like millions on top of millions on top of millions, you know what I'm saying, for...
Well, you know what? What Mac Miller did was... He, in essence, just put the instrumental down and put the needle on the record and then just rhyme to it and sold it on iTunes. So, you know, so he didn't sample it. He just played the record out and rhymed over it. Can't do that, fam. Now, if it was a mixtape, that's different. But you're selling records on iTunes, and you're not crediting people. You can't do that. I can't rhyme over a Sly Stone instrumental, or a Barry White instrumental, and sell it on iTunes. You can't do that. You know what I mean? And Finesse took a lot of flack for that from people who really didn't know the whole story. They felt that, here's this legendary rapper, just suing somebody for some money. Nah, it wasn't that. It's just the principle. And then when Finesse tried to, reach out to dude was like apprehensive. Hmm. And that made it worse. Twice. You know what I mean? So, somebody try to blow you off, that's that sucker shit.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And at the end of the day, they came to an agreement, and it was settled out. You know what I mean? But Finesse definitely took some flack from people who really didn't know the whole story. And Mac Miller tried to say, Finesse, the song itself is, you took samples and made it. And Finesse was like, yeah, I put that together. I took a note here, a note there, a note there, and I transposed it. I did the work.
Right.
What you did, fam, is you bought the 12-inch instrumental, dropped the needle on the record, and just rhymed to it. And then you got the nerve to put it on iTunes and don't credit nobody? Nah, you out your mind, fam.
Yeah, that's crazy. So we're going to jump around a little bit now. You produced a lot of records, man, a lot of classic records, but you also produced some records where I got to ask you, what were you thinking? Like, did you want to do it, or was it a check, or was it a challenge? And the one thing that comes to mind is one of our buddies, James Andrews, who used to be in the record business, now works in the tech world, put together the Basketball's Best Kept Secrets album.
Right.
That you did the joint with Cedric Ceballos and right. Dana Barrows.
And the Brand Nubian.
And Brand Nubian. So how was you used to working with cats that can spit?
Right.
How was it for you working with cats who you might have had to coach a little bit, like, yo?
Well, that project, it was funny. Like, we love basketball players, and
yeah.
They love rappers. Here we are drinking and smoking and talking about basketball, talking about beats. It was just like that. It was mainly just a fun thing to do.
Gotcha.
You know what I mean? And the checks was nice too.
Yeah, no doubt.
You know what I mean? So there it is.
It's you're a big Knicks fan, and I've heard you say that it was like an honor to have the late Anthony Mason in the video for Best Kept Secret, man. You remember that day and how everything went down?
Definitely. The director, David Perez, he said, I got a surprise for you. So I'm like, okay, well, fuck is a surprise? And then Anthony Mason came through, and he shot his scene, and everything just came together. I was definitely one of the first to incorporate, professional sports player in a hip hop video. You know what I mean? So I'm proud of that. Rest in peace, my man Anthony Mason.
Definitely, definitely. So what you think about that? We free agency now is crazy. Last 3-4 days, everybody moving around. What you think about the moves your Knicks are making?
I haven't really been following it, but I do know Kevin Durant is going to Golden State, right?
Yeah.
And this man is ecstatic. He's doing Facebook Live posts.
I just think it's funny. I'm a for real Golden State fan. Like, I've been going to games since the 80s.
Right.
But I didn't care whether he came or not. They're still a great team regardless. Exactly. Exactly. I just think it's absolutely hilarious how angry people are over him coming.
Right.
Like, people act like,
listen, you can't fault that man for looking out for him and his family.
Nah, not at all.
Because that's what drives the choice that drove the choice that he made.
Right.
The same choices that drove LeBron to leave Cleveland and go to Miami.
Exactly.
I gotta do what's best for my family, for me and my family.
Exactly.
I love the fans, but I'm not going to live and die for y'all. I got to do what's best for me.
Yeah, how many players done went to a high school that wasn't in their district so they could play for a better sports program?
Right.
Or anything like that. Like, come on, man. Right. People need to stop.
But see, our second guest, I know he got something to say about it. He came in talking about
Man. What you think about Porzingis and how he's gonna gel with Melo and Derrick Rose and everybody?
I'm a diehard Knicks fan.
Speak on it.
So I'm gonna tell y'all straight up. I'm happy. What I want to say, I'm not gonna say, but.
Come on, man. Ain't no, we don't do this. No hose bar, man.
Oh, no hose bar?
No hose bar, man.
All right, well, first and foremost, I got to give a big shout out to everybody watching live. Hey, on Gina. She's tuning in. But honestly, man, Porzingis with Brandon Jennings, Courtney Lee, Carmelo Anthony. I mean, the Knicks stepped their game up 150%, like straight up. Now, watch how many people ride the bandwagon. Watch. Watch. Yeah. And Kevin Durant, that was a sucker move he pulled. I don't care what nobody say. Like, you just ran.
A lot of players, I've heard some players off the record agree with what you got to say, for sure. I just... Mm-hmm.
They just mad because they ain't getting offered them numbers.
Yeah, I mean, my thing is this. Somebody, because they're saying Dwayne Wade might go to Cleveland for less money just despite... Miami, and they're like, but it, and I was like,
see, you, it's, they I, say, I don't think it should spike Miami. I think it may, maybe to get some more rings.
They offered him 80
for Bulls, how many years?
The Bulls offered him 80 for 2 years,
the Bulls did.
That's crazy.
80 M for 2 years,
yeah. They're not playing for the love of the game no more, man. This is about chess, man. They're moving across that board to get
that
bread.
They want to win. Everybody wants to win. My thing is this, people will be like, well, it's not the same thing. If Wade goes to Cleveland as Durant going to Golden State. My thing is this, if Miami would have been made it out the second round, it would be the same thing.
Right.
It ain't like, it's about winning and losing, man. Ain't nobody tripping on none of that.
That's right, about winning and losing.
So, and everybody play for Nike, technically, any damn way. So,
yeah, Nike, Under Armour, Adidas.
What's crazy is it's not even earned anymore. It's like these are easy teams being thrown together.
Like, well, I mean, you can't say that with Golden State because everybody on the team other than Durant was drafted by the team that's putting in.
Exactly. They were put together and they stayed together. I don't get it, man.
Like, since we're touching on the West Coast, man, I mean, like, you've worked with cats like the Licks, Far Side, Cavs,
House Exhibit. Of Pain.
Exactly, man. So it's like, what drew the energy out there for you to work with, you know, like the L.A. cats throughout your career,
well,
man?
Well, they reached out to me.
Okay.
You know what I mean? And, you know, they reached out to me. You know, the East Coast, West Coast thing, it wasn't really in full steam at that point. But even when that was going on, that was basically between two camps of people. You know what I mean? It didn't affect the rest of the world.
Definitely. What I always loved, the chemistry that you had with the Alcoholics, man.
Yeah.
Like, not only... producing joints, but you know, rapping on the joints or whatever. What was it about them and their style that you guys mesh so well together?
Yo, they just some cool motherfuckers, man. You know what I'm saying? E Swift, J Ro, Tash. You know, and I went out to LA. They showed me mad love. You know, E had the house up in the Hollywood Hills. You know, shit was cracking out there. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm like, damn. You know, I'm a New York dude and. You know, I'm out here seeing how these dudes is living. You know, they riding around in hot rods, you know, living in, you know, motherfucking $500,000 homes back then. You know, it was just everything, you know, and they made me feel right at home. They came to the Bronx. They hung out with me there. You know, we all just clicked. You know what I mean? And I actually made the tracks in front. Well, I made Next Level. Ooh. That was done already, but I did two tracks. I did Next Level and I did Let It Out. And Let It Out, I actually put that together in front of them in the Bronx. And it just, you know, it just came out. And that's another sample I used. And then maybe a year later, Ill and Al Scratch touched on it too.
I forgot about that one too. Mm-hmm. You might be like the most copied producer. Like, that's crazy.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? As a producer, man, like, obviously times have changed a lot because, like, I was following what Flying Lotus had to say a few weeks ago on Twitter. I don't know if anybody caught that, but he was on there pretty much saying how stressing how, you know, producers should, you know, really focus on knowing their worth, especially with all these mixtapes and artists just insisting on giving away music for free and using that as an excuse for, well, I'm not going to pay you because I'm not selling a CD. You should be happy that you're on my album so that I can, so you can get exposure. You know what I'm saying? And he also talked about something that you just brought up, like making beats in front of people and how, you know, he thought that, you know, cats should charge that on top of their rate too. Because, like, if you're going to ask me to sit in there and make the beat as if what I just presented with you, you know, to, on CD is not good enough for you, like, what are we doing here? So, like, as a producer coming from your era and seeing how things work now, like, I guess, like, if there is a side of the fence to, you know, be on, like, are you for the whole, like, free music thing? This is a good look for you? Do you prefer making beats in the studio
still? The only time I'm for free music is if I'm promoting something of my own that I'm working on specifically for myself. You know, the free music thing, I don't know where it came from. But, you know, it has pluses and it has minuses. You know, this is the music business. So, you know, we're all in this to generate some type of income. But we also live in an era where people want to hear some of the music before they purchase it, you know, and that goes back 20 years, you know, even in the 90s. If somebody dropped the album, if you weren't a diehard fan, you wanted to hear at least two or three, maybe four songs that you liked before you went into Tower Records or Best Buys or, you know, any of the other major chains back then. Virgin Music record stores, you know, any of those big CD chains, you know, you wanted to hear at least three or four songs that you liked before you purchased it. So, you know, in that respect, it's similar.
What do you think about the whole advent of streaming and cats charting from, you know, essentially people not buying the music but just kind of leasing the music or just listening to it at certain points?
I mean, streaming is cool, but the rates that they pay us, the artists, you know, is minuscule. You know, it's next to nothing. You know what I mean? So in that respect, Tidal offers the best streaming deals for artists. But, you know, Spotify, all the rest of them, you know, they're there, but, you know, they pay very little residuals to artists.
And I can imagine how, you know, it's like non-beneficial it can be for, like, producers, because, like, hell, you don't know who's making the stuff anymore, man. They don't put any kind of credits.
I honestly miss buying an album and flipping through, seeing who produced what, seeing what was sampled so I can go back and listen to that song.
Exactly.
Like, I don't. Like, I would, it doesn't cost much to just do liner notes. If we can email stuff written, then they need to just add it on there. If you buy an album, like, it makes sense not to
have. If you download music, you don't have that.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah, it's
you know what I mean. And don't get me wrong, you know, I enjoy downloading music. You know, it's instant.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. But like you, you know, I came up and I enjoyed buying the CD and reading the credits, reading the liner notes, finding out who produced what, who played bass, who played keyboards. You know, it was just the whole package. You know what I mean? And, you know, CDs are still around.
Yeah.
You know, but nobody's really buying CDs like that anymore. So record labels, you know, the major labels, of course, they, you know, they're in the business to make money. So they pulled back on how many CDs that they're going to press. You know, unless you're a major, major artist, then they'll do a large run of CDs. But for the most part, you know, we live in a digital world.
Yeah, because, like, hell, the cell phone section at Best Buy bigger than the CD section now. I'm like, God damn. What happened?
Crazy.
Real talk. One record that I didn't even know until very recently, you produced it, and it's one of my favorite records from this artist, is The Light from Pharoah Monch. Like, I had no idea.
Who you thought did?
I didn't know.
Okay.
I had no idea.
Well, if you close your eyes, who does it sound like?
When you listen to the, not what you immediately hear, but the underlying stuff, it sounds like you.
Okay.
But it just, I had no idea whatsoever that you produced that record, man. How did that whole thing come about?
Again, Pharoah reached out to me. You know what I mean? And I wound up doing, I think, 3 on that album. I did The Light, The Truth, and The Ass.
Yep. That's a dope record, too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So The Truth was with Common and Talib and Pharoah Monch. You know, that was my favorite of the three, even though The Light is the one that received most notoriety, mainly, you know, one of the reasons, because he actually did a video for that song.
Right.
You know what I mean? But musically, my favorite out of the three that I produced was The Truth.
It's like I'm seeing a recurring theme, you know what I'm saying, as far as artists that you work with. Like, it seems like they all reach out to you for, you know, like a specific, you know, sound or aesthetic. Like, how important is it to, like, you know, grow your own sound and to a degree stick to it, not assuming that, you know, you're like, I'm only doing this kind of thing, right, you know what I'm saying? But like, how important is it to, like, mold your sound and craft it to the point where it's like, okay, I can only get that from this person?
Well, I think it's very important for every producer to have a staple sound. You know, something that makes you stand apart. You know, and it gives the artist a reason to even track you down.
Mm.
You know what I mean? So, you know, everybody should have a signature sound. And all great producers do. Definitely. Myself, Q-Tip, Pete Rock, Premier, J Dilla, High Tech, Knots. You know, we all are similar, but we all different.
Were you ever tempted to, like, jump off the bridge sometimes? Especially, like, as much back and forth that you do in Atlanta, it's like,
mm-hmm.
this place is an easy place to get caught up in the wave. Like, oh, man, that's what they doing over there. That's what everybody got on. You know what I'm saying? Like, have you ever been tempted to be like, all right, man, let's see what the new Diamond D can do? And, you know what I'm saying?
Nah, but there are artists that I work with and are currently working with where, you know, musically it allowed me to step out of my box, so to say. You know what I mean? And those are the projects that I'm actively pursuing right now. I don't want to be remembered as one of the kings of the underground sound.
Hmm.
It's just so much more to me.
Hmm.
But at the same time, I embrace my legacy. You know what I mean? I'm proud of it.
Definitely. Now, when you say that, like, what comes to mind immediately to me is how Premier is very much revered for all of the underground, the boom bap, but he's also made tons of money working with Christina Aguilera. He also has this artist out now. I can't remember her name, the singer. So are you saying that, like, there's so many different lanes that your sound can work in?
And has so, worked in.
Yeah.
Exactly. You know, you know, we can go back to TLC Creep. I did one of their remixes.
Yeah.
You know, when I worked with the Fugees and I won a Grammy for my work on The Score, which wasn't a boom bap album.
Nah, not at all.
It had boom bap qualities, but it was just multicultural, multi-layered. I was nominated for a Grammy for my work with Natalie Cole. You know what I mean? For the song Daydreaming in 2007. I'm working with an artist right now called the Blake Moses Project. So, you know, definitely, you know, you can't be afraid to step out of your box. Just try new different things.
Definitely.
And then, like, even your sound to begin with, man, like, it just kind of reminds you of that feeling that you got when you first got put on the stuff. You know what I'm saying? Because I always remember, like, this interview. Like, no disrespect to dude. What's the kid? Mark Ronson. You know what I'm saying? You know, some folks, they look at people in the mainstream, look at him like, he is the expert on all things hip hop. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, if you listen to, like, an NPR interview, they're like asking him shit, like, he's just the genius.
Right.
And, like, they were mentioning how, you know, like, he would sample something. He was like, yes, that's a Run DMC sample. That's a so and so sample. But one thing I did pick up from the conversation, he was saying, you know, people are always going to want the authentic original, no matter how new things get.
Right.
You know, you still gotta have some kind of song or, you know, sound in there where people are gonna, like, be like, wow, that sounds like something from the original.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? That it gives it that authentic, you know what I'm saying, feel off top.
You said Mark Ronson?
Yeah.
Is he the one who made Uptown Funk?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, well, exactly. You know, Uptown Funk. You know, that song, it gave people a feeling of the time.
Definitely.
Lakeside. You know, just all of those cameo, all of those big funk crews from the 80s. And Mark Ronson, he said that that was the sound he wanted to try to recreate. And that song went on to win numerous awards. He sold millions of records. So it just goes to show that everything runs in cycles, and we all know that. You know what I mean? And, you know, to see you know, little kids singing Uptown Funk and dancing to it, you know, to these sounds that were basically prolific 30 years ago.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So, you know, shouts out to Mark Ronson for reaching back and recreating that funk sound.
Definitely.
You know what I mean?
Outside of, I would say, Finesse and Fat Joe, I would have to say the artist or the group that you are most synonymous with, that you have probably worked with more than anyone else outside of your camp, is Brand Nubian. Both, you know, solo, together, the whole nine. And, you know, the song that most people probably remember is the Punks Jump Up, which has like 25 different mixes. What? The three main ones. Like, why did that come about? Because I know I remember buying the album being like, hold on, man. This ain't the version that I know. And then had to go and find it. I think at some point we even was doing, we interviewed somebody affiliated and ripped. Like, I think I had to pull it off YouTube because I couldn't find the one that I wanted to play on the show at all. But how did that whole thing come about with Punks Jump Up and the three, the video mix, the album mix, the single mix, all of that?
Well, the album version was actually recorded first. Did the album version, and then we did the remix. The remix, I remixed it, of course, and I rhymed on there.
Yep.
Right? And then boom, I think the session that I was doing the remix, I had like an hour left, maybe 90 minutes, something like that, and I didn't want to leave. You know, I'm a lab rat, so I was like, well, I'm going to use this time for something. And I spent that last hour putting together the Punks Jump Up beat that wound up being the big one that blew up.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? That was actually the last version done.
One day when I was riding on the train, I seen these two kids talking about the Nubian rain had fallen. I didn't say nothing cause these kids caught my goat. Even wore my coat like a murder that they wrote. So this kid with mouth swagger now blazed the cloak and dagger. So I got to show Deuce to my Sherlock that I am. I could rock a jam, make the world drop ham. Oh yes, I'm the bad man and bad men wear black. And if it comes to dropping bombs, yo, I'm with that. Now I can freak, block, flow, fuck up a faggot. Don't understand the ways and I ain't down with days. You wanna drop the style that was made from my mom and my dad. When I was young, I used to run with a notepad. Then time flew and somehow I knew that I was bad to the bone. Black prodigy since the age of 20. I could write a rhyme, rip it up and write the next one. Right on the spot, sign my name with a dot. Diamond D threw me some smooth shit, Bronx crowd roar. Took up your whack jam, everybody hit the floor. Okay, it's you, Slim, the hard rock of the pack. Don't wanna kneel to the brothers. You must be holing, bust some shit in his chest. Now his whole body's swollen. Why did I have to do it? He asked for it, his man saw it. So it don't mean shit to me. He's gone, that's how it's supposed to be. Check it out now, I ain't going out, man, that short shit is dead. Have you heard what I said? If not, ask the dread. He got a cannon that's bad, similar to the one that I got from my old dad.
Punks are about to get beat down. Yep, nothing but a beat. Punks are about to get beat down. Yep, nothing but a beat. Punks are about to get beat down. Yep, nothing but a beat. Punks are about to get beat down. Yep, nothing but a beat.
Your punk ass will be grass quick fast like my name was Flash when a nigga try and rob me for my cash. You thought you had a sweet Vic, nice pick, but you didn't anticipate that I might be sick. Now who's the trick, cause I'm not a hoe.
No.
I always do the fucking, just might do the bucking. I leave my Nike stuck in your rectum till you learn. Brand new being, yo, you gotta respect them.
That's wild, and that's a classic record.
And it went on, you know. I remember Leo Cohen, he heard it. You know, that's the one right there. We're going to run with this one, Diamond. That's the one right there.
You know what I mean? Everybody has a Leo impression for sure. How did it feel, man, for, so you know, these guys are your peers. You've been working with, you know, Sadat, Grand Puba, Lord Jamar, Alamo, the whole nine since the inception of their career. How did it feel for you, for Sadat X, to make a song and call it Diamond D the Great?
Yeah, you know with Sadat, you never know what he's going, you know, what he going to name it. And when he named that, you know, I was like, hey, that's what's up. And then he had my man Sean P on there, rest in peace.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So, yeah, you know, it definitely felt good. You know, me and Sadat, I got a new album that I produced for Sadat. I'm going to release it probably in the fall. It's called The Sum of a Man. And I produced everything in its entirety. And I'm definitely going to bless you up with one of the joints off of there before I get up out of here today.
Dope. Much appreciated. And I got to, you know, we got to ask, because I think you probably drop an album like every 5 years. You make us wait a little bit. So we're going to have to wait till 2019 for the next Diamond D solo album.
Nah. I'm actually recording the Dime Piece Volume 2 right now.
Dope. Okay.
You know what I mean? The Dime Piece Volume 1 was well received when it came out 2 years ago. You know what I mean? I'm very proud of that album. A lot of nice bangers on there. You know, the joint with me and Pete Rock, the joint with me and High Tech, the joint with me and Pharoah Monch,
Scram.
Fat Joe, Bumpy Knuckles, Chi Ali, the joint with Talib Kweli, Sky Zoo, and Elza. You know, it was just a crazy album, and got a lot of good press.
Definitely. You know, definitely. Last question, being that you travel a lot, you live here, you're still in New York a lot, what do you think of not only the artists that are coming out now from New York, but all the younger artists, but also what do you think of the reception that they're getting, both positive and negative, from just fans and media and all of that?
Well, who are you talking about specifically?
I mean, you have every. I mean,
do you have a name?
I mean, everybody from, you know, from Troy Ave, the designer, to Trey Pizzy, to ASAP Mob. I don't think ASAP Mob can be considered new anymore.
Designer, they're both from Brooklyn.
But yeah,
that's it.
Yeah,
there's no correlation between the two.
Gotcha.
Troy Avenue is, you know, more or less new wave, boom bap, gangster shit. And Designer is, you know, just, he's making listen, Designer, I don't know how old he is. You know, he might
19.
Be.
19.
How old?
19.
Okay. He just went to his prom.
Okay, so that's my point. He grew up listening to, you know, to trap music.
Yeah.
Basically, because that's what's been dominating the airwaves, you know, the past 5 or 6 years. You know, the Southern music.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And as a teenager, you want your music played on the radio, so you emulate that. When I was a teenager, I wanted my shit to sound like A Tribe Called Quest and De La Soul, you know what I mean, and Public Enemy. That's how I wanted my shit to sound like. So I think, you know, just growing up, whatever music is relevant, you tend to gravitate toward that. At 19 years old, we shouldn't expect Designer to have the same musical taste that people from my era have. It don't work like that. You know what I mean? When I was a teenager, I didn't have the same musical taste that my uncles had. You know, to them, you know, they were fine listening to Earth, Wind & Fire and Marvin Gaye all fucking night. You know, I didn't want to hear that all night. I wanted to hear some hip-hop music. You know, so, you know, Designer, he's definitely catching a lot of flack. But you know what? You know, he's 19, and you know he's making music that he's grew up listening to, and that's it. You know, he got a big song out now. When I found out he was from Brooklyn, I was like, you're shitting me. I couldn't fucking believe it. But you know, it is what it is. You know what I mean? And I travel around the country all the time. I don't care if you're in Chicago, Detroit, L.A. When you cut the radio on, You hear Southern hip hop. That's just what's running shit right now. You know what I mean? And you know, you gotta respect it. You know what I mean? Whatever you do, you gotta respect that. You know what I mean? So you know, if you're a young artist, 18, 19, you know what I mean? And, you know, that's what you're gonna do.
Okay.
And even people from my era, some of my peers, you know, they trying to step out of their box. You know what I mean? But you know what? I want to give props to Fat Joe, because Fat Joe got a major hit out right now.
Yeah.
And he stayed in his lane. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not a trap record. It's a club banger. But that's what Fat Joe makes. He makes them club bangers. So he stayed true to himself. And, you know, that record was number one in Atlanta.
Yeah.
Like 2 weeks ago.
It's a crazy record, though.
No doubt. It's, you know what I mean?
It's a crazy
record. But he didn't have to
pander to.
Right.
Yeah. 100%.
That's nice panda. I like
that. no pun intended.
Right. Yeah. Quick on your feet.
Is it any? And I just thought about the. I don't know what made me think about it, but it's certain artists that I would love to hear, newer artists over your production. Is it any cats that you would like to work with now, the younger guys that you feel like you could bring something out of them, or you guys would sound great together?
Yeah, I want to work with Drake. You know, I'm gonna have to.
That would be. I'm not even a Drake fan, but that would be dope.
At 40, see if he can make that happen.
Hmm. Yeah,
you know what I mean. But you know, Drake, you know, incredible artist. You know, I definitely want to work with him. You know what I mean? So.
I'm looking forward to stuff like that, because, like, man, I don't know if y'all heard it, but like that 2 Chainz
Static Selector, that shit is hard.
Yeah, I heard it.
That shit is dope. I would like to hear you work with like a cat like Schoolboy Q. I think that shit would be incredible.
Yeah, definitely. Schoolboy Q, I fucked with him. You know, he did, matter of fact, he did a few drinks with the Alchemist.
Yeah, he did. Yeah,
you know
definitely.
What I mean? So you know, the link is there.
For sure, most of we gotta hear that. Reach out, people, because right. You know he only works with folks that reach out to him. we've established that on this interview. last thing. Obviously, you're number one on your list of producers on the mic. So give me 4 other guys that you feel like are top 5, or ladies that are top 5 producers on the mic.
Top 5 lady producers?
No, top 5 producers on the mic, whether they be men or women.
Well, you know what? Alright, well, if I'm one, I'll name the other 4.
Okay.
I definitely fucked with Dilla on the mic.
Okay.
You know what I mean? I fucked with Dilla. I fucked with Havoc. Grand Poobah. I know that's left field, but you know, Pooh Bah, you know, people forget Pooh Bah produced a lot of them songs with that brand Nubian album.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
One more.
Who can I say?
don't get political on us now.
It's more than 4, but I'm gonna put my man Q-Tip out there.
Okay.
Pete Rock, Alchemist, Quick.
Yeah, definitely.
You know, Lord Finesse, another one. I'm leaving people out. Knots. I fuck with Knots on the mic. You know what I mean? I'll leave it there.
Okay. All right. No doubt. Well, man, we most definitely appreciate you coming through. Please let the people
man,
know.
Yo, this is a good interview. You know, I hate doing interviews where motherfuckers ask me dumbass questions. Man, I was hoping when I walked up here, I was like, I hope these dudes got they shit together. Yo, the questions were on point, and I'm really glad I came down here. I know y'all been trying to get me to come down here. You know, for at least a year or so.
Yeah.
But, you know what I'm saying? I told you last week I was going to make it. And actually got here on time, too.
No doubt. I appreciate it, man. Please let people know where they can reach you on social media and whatnot.
Yeah, you can follow me on Twitter, DiamondDITC. Instagram, the same thing, DiamondDITC. And, you know, just hit me up. Questions, productions, whatever. It's all good.
Appreciate it, man. You're listening to Day One Radio on ABLRadio.com. Make sure you follow us, DAY, the number one radio. And also, if you're in Atlanta every Wednesday, make sure you come out to Slice 75 Piedmont for our hip-hop trivia event. It's pretty dope. You might you never know who you might see in there. Andre 3000, Killer Mike, a whole lot of people ran through that. So make sure you fuck with us on that. Follow us at Hip Hop Trivia ATL, and we'll see you next week with another dope show.
All right.
And you don't stop. Yeah. Going out to my man Chovy Cho, Grandmaster Supreme and all that. My name is Diamond, yep, you've guessed it. Ran 1,000 schemes and I've never been arrested. I guess I'm lucky cause I'm young and I'm a black man. And intelligent, so everything is relevant. Vision is clear, don't have to wear contacts. Got a good lawyer, no shorts in my contract. Beats are selected with the highest scrutiny. I played Mr. Christian and just take mutiny. Cause it's my destiny, a lot of brothers keep testing me. But you haven't heard the best from me. So remember one thing. Ayo, it ain't no thing but a chicken wing. Yeah, so sit back and listen to the chit-chat. Sweet as a Kit Kat. Diamond, where'd you get that beat from? Yo, Jazzy Duck in the crate needs another loop, so we added a flute. Then it came together and I grabbed the pen. Then I double-checked it.
For what?
Loose ends. The object of a song is to keep your head moving. Hope you find a good A&R, man. A lot of acts get signed. And when the album comes out, everyone says,
aw, man, take that record off. Don't waste my time.
Due to that fact, I went for mine. And I went for mine. Hey, yo, I went for mine. I went for mine. So go for yours. I went for mine. Hey, yo, I went for mine. I went for mine. So go for yours, kid. I overcome hurdles like Edwin Moses. Everything was planned, but no one knows this. I'll never go broke, so I don't sweat that. I make moves like a man on X-Lax. T-I to the A-M to the O-N-D. Ayo, you got no wins, G. So back up and take a breather. Cause either you must be on acid or from Lake Placid. I hop to it like a kangaroo. I got jumped by a gang or two, but I showed them a thing or two. Cause I'm not no chump. Now I clock notes cause I make you move your rump. Nothing's for granted. Grew up in the projects. Used to wear tailors and Chinese mock necks. Came a long way from back in the days when show went to Smith and I went to Hayes. That was the past and the future will be better. Pass them away and keep the cream Armanetta. Peace to Greg Nice and my man Fat Joe. My man OG and the rest of the homies. The Zulu Nation for the foundation. From when I was a kid watching Lost in Space. And I'll never forget cause I'm totally committed to make slamming joints just to prove my point. In 92 you can't waste no time.
Word.
Go for yours cause I went for mine. And you know that and you don't stop. And you know that cause I won't drop. I went for mine. Ayo, I went for mine. And to my sister Eugenia house. I went for mine, so go for yours, kid. And to my man Showbiz, all that. Lord Finesse, huh.
Y'all know what it is. Mikey James.
I be feeling like I'm God when I'm in the club. Paparazzi popping bottles, that's the fuck. That's for my haters, take a bow when I walk and rub.
What? What you know about the what?
I be feeling like I'm God when I'm in the club. Paparazzi popping bottles, that's what's up. That's for my haters, take a bow when I walk and rub.
Take off, I'm flashy like that. Know
black Lambo, black Wraith, black up all the way. Gangsta, gangsta ways. Lituation is lit today. Go hard on my teeth today. Black card on my teeth today. Rap guard on my teeth today. I'm strapped hard, no shit today. In the club, not sanctified. They're in the club, just gentrified. Pump fake it, pump fake it, pump fake it, gentrified. Fake bills and credit cards. Fake rims on Reddit cars. I stay lit, no plane.
Nope.
Take a bow with a city guard.
shifting through them lanes while I hit the throttle. All them chicks the same, I'm chillin' with this model. She strutting in them jeans, you other chicks just waddle. Broke ass mother can't afford a bottle.
I be feeling like I'm God when I'm in the club. Paparazzi popping bottles, that's what's up. All my haters take a bow when I walk the rug.
What you know about the what?
I be feeling like I'm God when I'm in the club. Paparazzi popping bottles, that's what's up. All my haters take a bow when I walk the rug.
Cause I'm flashy like that. What you know about that?
Crash the party, let it off. We in here, set it off. Drop that cash, let it off. Them lanes, get them all. Big stunt, crazy stunt. Faking jacks, crazy stunt. Focus, crazy stunt. Pumping what? They pumping nothing. Same old games they try to play. Never did those, won't try to get. Bird ass shit just fly away. Crooked ass cops just die today. I'm a guard in the club, blow your mind away. Got chicks on the floor, take your mind away. From the everyday bullshit to wine today. Stacks on stacks from the crime today.
You witness how I do it, and I do it well. Paparazzi taking flicks that they can sell. Shorty's on me hard, her man is mad as hell. Only winners over here, we can never fail.
I be feeling like I'm God when I'm in the club. Paparazzi popping bottles, that's what's up. All my haters take a bow when I walk the rug.
What you know about that? What?
I be feeling like I'm God when I'm in the club. Paparazzi popping bottles, that's all my haters take a bow when I walk the rug.
Cause I'm flashy like that. But you know what?
What up? This is Hitty.
What's going on? It's Dow Jones.
We're at the business.
Checking out ABL Radio with all our family.